I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's best-selling novel of the pursuit of a damned couple. The wife of the red-haired man. Starring Patty Duplantis. John Astin. And Howard Duff. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Quaker State Motor Oil, Alka-Seltzer, and MEM. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
And now for the concluding episode of The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. After 7 years in prison, Hugh Rohan is returned to claim his wife, Mercedes. In a confrontation with her second husband, Albert Turner, Rohan panics and murders Turner. Out of her love for Rohan, Mercedes Turner collects her jewels and her fur coat, and together the lovers flee. After long weeks of painstaking work, they've traced the couple to Kansas City. But once again, Mercedes Turner and Hugh Rohan evade them by splitting up. She to take a bus to New Orleans, he to drive their car alone.
I've been right. Roadblocks had been set up on highways leading to New Orleans. But the police were looking for two people in a gray compact car. And the bus I was on was stopped only long enough for an officer to question the driver. He was waiting for me in the nearly deserted hotel on Tupelo Street. He was in bed, his temperature raging. He seemed fuzzy with his fever. Although he did struggle out of bed to greet me.
So glad to see you. I thought you weren't going to come.
You sick?
Oh, no, it's just a cold. I froze driving that heap without my coat. You were right about the roadblocks.
Come on now. Get back in bed, honey.
Okay. Oh, that's better. Phew. It's hot.
I'll get some aspirin.
No, that's okay. Stay with me. That's the most important medicine. That you stay with me.
All right. What about the roadblock?
Oh, they stopped me. If I'd had my gun, I'd have shot my way through, but they didn't even ask questions. Man alone, blue car instead of gray, different plates.
Hugh, you said you would have shot your way through?
I told you, Mercy. I won't go back, and I won't be separated from you again. Here. Christmas present for you.
Perfume. My favorite perfume. You remember it.
I can't ever forget anything about you.
You want me to ask where you got the money? All right. Where?
Kansas City. I had a part-time job. Stock boy.
Just to buy me a Christmas present.
Is there a better reason to work?
I think it's the best present. Oh, I have something for you, too.
A pipe. With a bowl trimmed in silver. You remembered.
Honey, remember before we were married? You told me if you had me, and you were a doctor who smoked a silver-trimmed pipe, you'd be content. That was all you wanted.
Yeah.
Merry Christmas, honey. You don't, please. Don't cry, please.
What happened? Mercy, what happened?
I don't know. Life. Life happened.
It's so unfair.
Yeah.
Mercy. Hmm? You remember I told you that I knew what the cop was thinking? Do you remember?
Yes.
Well, we got through the roadblock, but he hasn't stopped. He's on to us. He knows what we're planning.
Shh.
Yeah, no, he's going to find me. And you know?
Shh. Hugh, please. Shh, please.
When he finds me, I'm going to kill him.
Rohan and the woman got through the roadblock somehow. Probably repainted the car and changed plates once again. Split up, perhaps. Only one of them was in the car when it passed the block. Stores line went straight into New Orleans. I knew my man by then well enough to know that he needed a port city from which to escape the country. Oh, they'll ship out from here.
Yeah. Well, they sure have a fantastic selection of ships.
They're all covered. Every ship, boat, plane, bus, everything's covered.
Well, you know, Will, you're assuming they're here in New Orleans.
They're here. I'll tell you something else. I'll be looking for passage to an English-speaking country. Someplace where they won't be conspicuous.
So? What's the game plan?
We're here. Can we wait? They've got to move. They can't stay. And the moment they try to leave the city, we've got them. Murder one.
We moved from the hotel the next morning, although Hugh still had a fever. I found an old rooming house, a private place the police would overlook. We were the only paying guests. It was a marvelous old home run by an ancient southern lady who appeared too frail to keep up such a place. But she cleaned and cooked and tended her overgrown garden. And for 2 weeks, Hugh and I didn't stir from that house. Finally, of course, Hugh had to make contact with Bert Crossley, the convict he'd known in prison, the man who gave us our passports. We were disappointed to find that Bert was back in prison. But he had a brother, Rick, who owned a bar just outside the Vieux Carré. And might be able to help us. Hugh went to see him.
Friend of Brother Bert, huh? Come on back to my office. What do you want?
I served time with Bert in Bordeaux. I'm Red Cargill.
Let's get rid of a question. You hot?
Plenty. I and my wife want to get out of the country.
With a lady along, that makes it rough.
I can pay for it, rough or not.
You have $5,000. That's what it'll take for 2 passports.
I have it.
Where do you want to go?
Australia, New Zealand, any place you speak English.
England?
No, not England. Or Canada.
Okay. Don't come back here again. Where can I reach you?
At this number. That's where this thing...
I don't know how long it'll take, but when I call you, be ready to move fast and have the $5,000 ready. Agreed?
Yes, agreed.
George and I sat there for 3 weeks. There was no sign of Rohan or the woman. Hotels, nightclubs, planes, trains, buses, ships, all covered, not a trace. I wasn't worried yet. I knew Rohan was someplace in the city. I could feel it. Sometimes he seemed so near, I half expected to bump into him around the next corner. Scores, however, had a problem.
I gotta get back, Will.
Homicide bugging you?
Well, the office is swamped.
Yeah. When are you leaving?
Flight this afternoon. What about you? You gonna stay?
You can depend on it.
We waited for Whit Crosley's call, afraid to leave the house for a minute. One of us must always be close to the phone, Hugh said. As the days passed, he refused to sleep, certain that Crosley's call would come in the middle of the night and he wouldn't hear it. And so his tension increased directly because of his lack of sleep. He paced the room continuously, back and forth, pausing only to listen for a telephone that never rang.
Hello?
Please, honey. Please lie down.
Has that cop gotten to him? Is that what's happened?
How could he?
Because he knows what I'm doing. I told you that. I told you he knows everything I think, every move I make.
Hugh.
Hello?
Coghill. Mercy, it's him. Listen.
Yeah, yeah.
Get down here right away. You'll leave in an hour. Just you.
But my wife.
Listen, no time to waste. Can't get you to Australia, but a ship I know. Standing off. Gonna drop a crewman for an emergency operation. I can fix the captain.
Where to?
Ireland. You better take it. Ship's not berthed here, but I can get you aboard in the launch. She's got a day's call in Miami, and your wife can join you there.
Mercy?
Take it. It's a good idea.
Okay, I'll be right down.
After Scores left, I spent my time haunting the docks. 100 times I thought I saw them, walking along a street or hurrying out onto a waiting ship, but it wasn't them. And gradually, a strange feeling occupied me. I lost the conviction that they were in New Orleans. Somehow, in some way, I felt certain they'd eluded me, slipped away. But how? How had they accomplished it? I made one last circle, walking from pier to wharf, covering as much of the waterfront as I could, one last time. Then, tired and thirsty, I stopped in a small bar, a place where seamen hang out. I met a Jamaican, a wiper, bought him a drink.
Cheers. Oh, need this drink, man. Just out of the infirmary, appendicitis. Rupture?
That's rough.
Captain had to set me ashore between Galveston and Miami. Nasty beat of business.
What ship?
Dermuid, out of Sydney. Captain Larson's master now. Now I need another berth.
That shouldn't be too hard.
No. I'm sorry I missed it, though. Sailing to Galway and Dublin. Never been there, you know.
You said the Dermuid was sailing to Ireland?
Right-o. First port of call, Galway.
Any stops between?
One day only, Miami.
Of course. Drink up. Galway, of course.
I drove alone from New Orleans to Miami, not daring to stop. The captain had arranged for me to be brought aboard, and soon I was with Hugh again. 2 weeks after that, we were dropped on the shore outside Galway, an old Irish port there almost from the beginning of time. We drove from Connaught to Connemara, through hamlets with names that fall from the lips like notes of music. Moycullen, Shindilly, Derrynane, Ballina Hinch, moors and rolling hills, and the grey rock crags of inlets sprayed by the lead-colored waters of the Atlantic. Near a tiny crossroads settlement by the sea, we found a little three-room cottage, whitewashed, cleansed by rains and bleached by the sun. We could run no further. That's where we would stay. One night, eating our dinner by a turf fire.
Take it away, Mercy. I'm not hungry. Do you hear it? There's something walking abroad tonight.
Your imagination?
No. Listen.
It's only the wind.
I hear it. It's there. It's the past, out there in the night.
I'm going to boil some water and fill the tub. A hot bath, honey. Good for your nerves. Come talk to me.
I'm busy. To the police. New York City.
What are you doing?
If anything happens, accident, anything, look in my pocket.
What are you saying?
Only that I love you.
The Dermuid hadn't made a scheduled stop and departure in New Orleans. It wasn't carried in the port bulletin. That's how I missed her. By the time I'd gotten the information on her, she'd reached Dublin and sailed on. The police in Ireland are a national organization. We alerted them, and 10 days later, they informed us they'd traced the couple. I wired Superintendent O'Hara not to arrest them yet, just to keep them under wraps. On an island, there's small chance of escape. With warrants for the arrest of Hugh Rohan and Mercedes Turner and papers for extradition, I flew to Ireland. From Shannon, I took a bus to Limerick, Limerick to Galway by rail. In Galway City, I was met by Inspector Green.
You have the necessary papers?
Yes, I have. All in order.
I've arranged for you to stay at the hotel. The papers will be approved this night.
Oh, you're not planning to pick them up until tomorrow?
No, it's a bit of a drive to the cottage. Here's my car. Yes. Are you carrying a gun?
Yes.
Well, we don't carry them here.
Well, you better tomorrow.
It won't be necessary.
He's armed. I know the man. He'll shoot it out.
That would be foolish of him.
Well, is it all right for me to carry mine?
If you insist. Yes, I can arrange it. It's most unusual.
I found it impossible to sleep that night. I've been after them for so long. For nearly 2 months, I'd held onto an invisible tether, the other end loosely fastened to Rohan and Mercedes Turner. Now, at last, when morning came, the final slack would be gathered in. I lay in the soft bed wondering what Rohan was doing. Did he know it was his last night of freedom? Did he hold Mercedes Turner in his arms, warm in his love?
Through that night, Hugh lay close to me. He spoke only once. "I'm cold," he said. "Please keep me warm." I kissed him. And his lips were like ice. In the morning, he arose early, shaved, dressed with care. We sat together at the table having our coffee. It had begun to rain. What are you planning to do today?
I don't know.
There's a beautiful abbey at Kylemore. Shall we go see it?
Perhaps, but it's a gloomy day.
Those cars outside.
I've been expecting them. Give me my gun.
Hugh, no. Please, no.
Where's your purse?
No more killing, Hugh, please.
We're officers of the law. You're under arrest.
Don't, Hugh. You're not a murderer. Don't.
They won't separate us. Not ever again.
Hugh, no!
I stood in front of the cottage door, the rain splashing against my collar, running down my neck. The end of the trail, a line drawn in. Suddenly the door swung open and Rohan's revolver stared me in the face. I threw myself to the ground. When he fired the second time, I shot him.
Oh, Williams! Are you hurt?
No.
Lucky bit for you.
Yes. Yes, isn't it? Yeah, if you don't mind, I'll join the laundry. Get the woman. Are you Mercedes Turner?
I'm Mercedes Rohan.
Your husband is dead.
Yes.
Did you know there were blanks in his gun?
Yes, I knew.
Did you put them there?
Yes. So he wouldn't kill again. He didn't know. I tried to stop him. Maybe it's just as well.
Williams, this was in his pocket.
Thank you.
He said, in case of an accident.
To the police. New York City. I alone shot and killed Albert Turner. My wife, Mercedes Turner Rohan, was not responsible in any way. It's signed Hugh Rohan.
Hugh.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
That concludes this week's production of The Zero Hour. Bill S. Ballinger's The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. Next week, we'll begin another exciting dramatization of a tale of mystery and suspense. We'll tell our story in 5 days, at the same time, Monday through Friday. So on Monday, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Quaker State Motor Oil, Alka-Seltzer, and MEM. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in Monday and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.